really good to put you bells to work. So this morning, in the tradition of many years of doing this in another town and bringing that tradition here, we tell a children's story, and you are invited to participate throughout the story. And the story is tied to Christmas. It's a Christmas story specifically. And it reminds us about why God actually loves our imperfections and why God chose to walk in a human form that was, by definition, imperfect. And so every time you hear the word snow, you should ring your bells all through the story. How's that sound? So you're going to be listening for the word snow. Got that? Yeah, practice snow. Everybody has a bell, and anybody who doesn't has a bell. Everybody has a bell now? All right, I'm going to play my voice for this story. I believe it will. And I wanted to tell you also that this was our daughter Jessie's absolute favorite story. She heard it during her lifetime, and we told it in a celebration later on too, because it's such a good story and we keep telling it. It's just so good. So this story is called, well, the main character in this story is a little tree called Small Pine. And this is a story about Christmas trees. There was a land where the most perfect evergreens grew. And the goal of all the evergreens as they grew was to be as straight and as perfectly tapered with the best turned up branches you could ever see, because the queen of the land would ride through the forest every winter looking for the perfect tree to cut down and bring back to her hall and decorate. All the trees, of course, wanted to be that perfect Christmas tree, to be chosen by the queen and to spend their life decorated and celebrated in the midst of all the wonder that is Christmas in the palace. There was a little perfect tree growing on the edge of the forest, and his name was Small Pine. He'd been listening to all those big trees give him all the advice about how just to grow himself into the perfectly shaped little evergreen. His branches curled just the right way. His trunk was perfectly straight, and there was a great point on the top of it. Some of the other trees were a little jealous because it looked like he was going to grow into just the right tree. As winter started approaching, it was getting closer and closer to time for the queen to come. And right about that time, one day, a rabbit came bounding through the forest. It was being chased by a predator, and it was looking for shelter. All the taller trees pulled up their branches as much as they could and refused to give shelter to the rabbit. And Little Pine didn't really want to do anything different from the other older trees, but as the rabbit approached Little Pine, he heard the howling behind the rabbit, and he saw the rabbit shivering, and the rabbit got closer and closer, and it got right under his trunk. And Little Pine dipped one of his perfectly tipped branches down to the snow. And he made a little shelter. His branches reached into the snow and froze them, making a little cave so that the predators that were howling and looking for the rabbit couldn't find the rabbit, and the rabbit was safe through the night. And in the morning, the rabbit hopped off back toward its own hole. And Little Pine tried to pull those branches back out of the snow. And so suddenly, Little Pine's smaller branches weren't so perfect anymore. And a few days later, a terrible blizzard blew through the valley. The winds were howling and the snow was flying. All the villagers slammed shut their windows, and all the animals took shelter, but there was a mother wren caught in the winds, caught in the wild snow. She was blown from tree to tree, and she kept looking for a place to land, and all the trees clenched their branches as if they were fists, because they wanted their perfect branches, and they were afraid she might ruin their shape. And Little Tree watched her blow closer and closer, and she landed on one of Little Tree's branches. And Little Tree made a kind of space for her in one of those branches. And just as the rabbit had done before, the wren spent the night sheltering in the hole that Little Tree had made in Little Tree's branches. And when she flew away the next morning, safe on the warmer winds of a new day, the hole was still there. Little Tree tried to bend Little Tree's branches back, but the snow and the cold had done their work and the hole remained. And then it got even colder, and the deer that lived in the woods were trying to find the last sweet green blades of anything to eat. And a fawn had been separated from its mother, and only the older, stronger deer with the sharper hooves could actually break through the ice crust and the snow to get to the last of the grass. Little fawn kept looking for something to nibble as it trembled and got weaker and weaker. And all the other trees curled up those branches so that there were no needles close to where the fawn could reach. And Little Tree watched the fawn come closer and closer. And Little Tree reached out those needles and those branches so that the fawn could nibble and survive another night and be restored with enough energy to return to its mother. By the time the fawn was done nibbling, all the edges of Little Tree's branches were pretty ragged. The snow sat on bare and that's just about the time that the Queen's sleigh started driving through the woods, across the snow, with a sleigh bell. The Queen was coming to choose the tree. And Little Tree felt the branches drooping and frozen to the ground and knew there was a hole, and realized that the edges of every branch were bare from having been nibbled away. And all the other trees drew themselves up as straight as they could as the Queen's sleigh came closer and closer through the snow. And they listened to the bell. And they waited for her to make her choice. And the Queen's sleigh was going right past Little Tree, and she looked at that tiny, ragged tree. "What is that tree doing in my forest? Someone should chop it right down." But then she looked again at the shape of the tree. She looked at the frozen branches bending in the wrong way. She looked at the hole where a bird had landed on the branches. She looked at the edges that had clearly been eating an animal. And her heart was changed by the misshapen, imperfect tree who had given itself over and over again rather than remain perfect, rather than continue to be the perfect, ideal tree that would be chosen for her hall. Little Tree had spent Little Tree's own beauty and body and being in service of others. And when she understood what the imperfect shape of that little tree meant, she instructed her woodsman indeed to bring Little Tree with her, but not because she wanted Little Tree to be discarded and taken out of her forest, but because Little Tree was the perfect Christmas tree. The other trees were shocked when they saw a Little Tree being loaded onto the sleigh and taken back through the snow to the Queen's palace. There, Little Tree was set up in the hall, covered in light, covered in berries and popcorn and all the good things that were beautiful. And the people sang around Little Tree and danced around Little Tree. And outside, the snow still blew. And winter wrapped around them. And after that, every year in that same wood, if you wanted to be chosen as the Queen's Christmas tree, you weren't tall and perfect anymore. You had holes and ragged edges, and you were bent in a funny way, because it was the love in Little Tree's being that she celebrated and continued to choose over and over again. When you hear the sleigh coming, know that you are beloved just as you are, your imperfect, wonderful Christmas tree self. Thank you.